it's nothing to pour out to our purpose at the moment. I have now to tell you how Wyvern made me a brig. When I went there, nothing was farther from my mind than the idea that my private taste for fairly good books or Wagner for mythology gave me any sort of superiority to those who read nothing but magazines and listen to nothing but then fashionable ragtime. The claim might seem unbelievable if I did not add that I had been protected from this sort of conceit by downright ignorance. Mr. Ian Hay somewhere draws a picture of the reading minority at the public schools in his day as boys who talked about GBS and GKC in the same spirit in which other boys secretly smoked. Both sets were inspired by the same craving for forbidden fruit and the same desire to be grown up. And I suppose boys such as he describes might come from Chelsea or Oxford or Cambridge, homes where they heard things about contemporary literature. But my position was wholly different. I was, for example, a great reader of Shaw. About the time I went to Wyvern, I had never dreamed that reading Shaw was anything to be proud of. Shaw was the author of my father's on my father's shelves, like any other author. I began reading him because his dramatic opinions contain a good deal about Wagner, and Wagner's very name was then a lore to me. Thence, I went on to read the most of the other Shaws we had, but how his reputation stood in the literary world, I neither knew nor cared. I didn't know there was a literary world. My father told me Shaw was a mountebank, but that there were some laughs in John Bull's Other Island. It was the same with all the other reading. No one, thank God, had ever admired or encouraged it. William Morris, for some unfathomable reason, my father always referred to as that whistle painter. No doubt I was conceited at Chartres for being good at my Latin. This was something recognized as meritorious, but Anglit was pleasantly absent from the official syllabus, so I was saved any possibility of conceit about it. Never in my life had I read a work of fiction, poetry, or criticism in my own language, except because after trying the first few pages, I liked the taste of it. I could not help knowing that most other people, boys and grown-ups alike, did not care for the books I read. A very few taste I could share with my father, a few more with my brother. Apart from that, there was no point of contact, and this I accepted as a sort of natural law. If I reflected on it at all, it would have given me, I think, a slight feeling, not of superiority, but of inferiority. The latest popular novel was so obviously a more adult, a more normal, a more sophisticated taste than any of mine. A certain shame or bashfulness attached itself to whatever one deeply and privately enjoyed. I went to the call for more disposed to excuse my literary taste than to plume myself on them. But this innocence did not last. I was, from the first, a little shaken by all that I soon began to learn. the wyvern, nay, a world in which a taste for such things was almost meritorious. I felt as Seyfried felt when it first dawned on him that he was not Mime's son. What had been my taste was apparently our taste, if only I could ever meet the we to whom that hour belonged. And if our taste, then by a perilous transition, perhaps good taste or the right taste, for the transition involves a kind of fall. The moment good taste knows itself, some of its goodness is lost. Even then, however, it is not necessary to take a further downward step of despising the Philistines, who do not share it. Unfortunately, I took it hitherto, though increasingly miserable at Wyvern. I had been half ashamed of my own misery, still ready, if I were only allowed to admire the Olympians, still a little overawed, cowed, rather than resentful. I had, you see, no standing place against the Wyvarian ethos, no side for which I could play against it. It was a bear I against what seemed simply the world. But the moment that I became, however vaguely, a we and wyvern, not the world, but a world, the whole thing changed. It was now possible, at least in thought, to retaliate. I can remember what may well have been a precise moment of this transition. A perfect called plug or glubbed or some such name stood opposite me, belching in my face, giving me some order. The belching was not intended as an insult. You can't insult a fag any more than an animal. If Bulb had thought of my reactions at all, he would have expected me to find his eructations funny. What pushed me over the edge into pure briggery was his face, the puffy bloated cheeks, the thick, moist, sagging lower lip, the yokel blend of drowsiness and cunning, the lout, I thought, the clawed, the dull, crass clown. For all his powers and privileges, I would not be he. I had become a prig, a highbrow. The interesting thing is that the public school system had thus produced the very thing which it was advertised to prevent or cure. For you must understand, if you have not been dipped in that tradition yourself, that the whole thing was devised to knock the nonsense out of the smaller boys, put them in their place. If the junior boys weren't fagged, as my brother once said, they would become insufferable. That is why I felt so embarrassed a few pages ago when I had to confess that I got rather tired of perpetual fagging. If you say this, every true defender of all of the system will diagnose your case at once, and they will all diagnose it in the same way. Ho, ho, they will cry, so that's the trouble. Though I thought yourself too good to black your betters' boots, did you? That just shows how badly you need it to be fagged. It's to cure young prigs like you that the system exists, that any cause except thinking yourself too good for it might awaken discontent with a fag's lot will not be admitted. You have only to transfer the summer evening, tired from work and with more work to prepare against the morrow. He could drag you to the links and make you his caddy till the light failed. If at last he dismissed you unthanked with a suitcase full of his clothes to brush and clean and return to him before breakfast, and a hamper full of his foul linen for your wife to wash and mend. And if under this regimen you were not always perfectly happy and contented, where would the cost lie except in your own vanity? What else, after all, could it be? For almost by definition, every offense a junior boy commits must be due to cheek or side, and to be miserable, even to fall short of rapturous enthusiasm, is an offense. Obviously, a certain grave danger was ever present to the minds of those who built up the wyvern variant Hierarchy. It seemed to them self-evident that if you left things to themselves, boys of 19 who played rugger for the country and boxed for the school would everywhere be knocked down and sat on by boys of 13, and that, you know, would be a very shocking spectacle. The most elaborate mechanism, therefore, had to be devised for protecting the strong against the weak, of the close corporation of old hands against the parcel of newcomers who were strangers to one another and to everyone in the place, the poor trembling lions against a furious and ravening sheep. There is, of course, some truth in it. Small boys can be cheeky and left in half an hour in society of a French 13-year-old makes most of us feel that there is something to be said for fagging after all. Yet I cannot help thinking that the bigger boys would have been able to hold their own without all complicated assurances, pattings on the back, and encouragement which the authorities gave them. For of course these authorities, not content with knocking the nonsense out of the sheep, were always coaxing and petting, and at least equal quantity of nonsense into the lions. Power and privilege and an applauding audience for the games they play might not be mere nature of boys, have done all and rather more than all that needed doing in this direction without assistance. But whatever the rationality of the design, I contended that it did not achieve its object. For the last 30 years or so, England has been filled with bitter, truculent, skeptical, debunking, and cynical intelligence. A great many of them were at the public schools and believed very few of them liked it. Those who defended the schools will of course say that these prigs are the cases which the system failed to cure. They were not kicked, mocked, fagged, flogged, and humiliated enough, but surely it is equally possible that they are the products of the system, that they were not prigs at all when they came to their schools, but were made prigs by their first year, as I was. For really, that would be a very natural result, where oppression does not completely and permanently break the spirit. Has it not a natural tendency to produce retaliatory pride and self-esteem, no one is more likely to be arrogant than a lately freed slave. I write, of course, only to neutral readers. With the wholehearted adherence of the system, there is no arguing. For as we have already seen, they have maxims and logic which they lay mind cannot apprehend. I have even heard them defend compulsory games on the ground that all boys except a few rotters like the games they have to be compulsory because no compulsion is needed. I wish I had never heard chaplains in the armed forces produce a similar argument in defense of the wicked institution of the church parades. But the essential evil of public school life, as I see it, did not lie either in the suffering of the fags or in the privileged arrogance of the bloods. These were symptoms of something more all-persuasive, something which in the long run did most harm to the boys who succeeded best at school and were happiest there. Spiritually speaking, the deadly thing was that school life was a life almost wholly dominated by the social struggle to get on, to arrive, or having reached the top to remain there. Was the absorbing preoccupation? It is often, of course, the preoccupation of adult life as well, but I have not yet seen any adult society in which the surrender to this impulse was so total, and from it at school as in the world, all sorts of meanness flow. The psychopathy that courts those higher in the scale, the cultivation of those whom it is well to know, the speedy abandonment of friendship that will not help on the upward path, the readiness to join the cry against the unpopular, the secret motive in almost every action, the wyverns seem to me, in retrospect, to have been the least spontaneous in that sense, the least boyish society I have ever known. It would perhaps not be too much to say that in some boys' lives, everything was calculated to the great end of advancement. For this, games were played. For this, clothes, friends, amusements, and vices were chosen. And that is why I cannot give pederasty anything like the first place among the evils of the call. There is much hypocrisy on this theme. People commonly talk as if every other evil were more tolerable than this. But why? Because those of us who do not share the vice feel for it a certain nausea, as we do, say, a necrophily. I think that of very little relevance to moral judgment, because it produces permanent perversion, but there is very little evidence that it does. The bloods would have preferred girls to boys, as if they could have come by them, when at a later age girls were obtainable, they probably took them. It is then on Christian grounds, but how many of those who fulminate on matter are in fact Christians, and what Christian in a society so worldly and cruel as that of Wyvern would pick out a carnal sins for special reprobation? Cruelty is surely more evil than lust, and the world at least as dangerous as the flesh. The real reason for all the pother is, in my opinion, neither Christian nor ethical. We attack worst, but because it is, by adult standards, the most disruptible and unmentionable, and happens also to be a crime in English law, the world will lead you only to hell, but sodomy may lead you to jail and create a scandal and lose you your job. The world, to do it justice, seldom does that. If thus to us of us who have known a school like Wyvern dare to speak the truth, we should have to say that pedestry, however great and evil in itself, was in the time and place and the only foothold or granny left for certain good things. It was the only counterpoise to the social struggle, the one oasis, though green only with weeds and moist only with voted water, in the burning desert of competitive ambition, in his unnatural love affairs, and perhaps only there, the blood went a little out of its himself, forgot for a few hours that he was one of the most important people there are. It is soft. It softens the picture. A perversion of only a chink left through which something spontaneous and uncalculating could creep in. Plato was right about all. Arrows turned upside down, blackened, distorted, and filthy, still bore traces of his divinity. What an answer, by the by, Wyvern was to those who derive all the ills of society from economics for money. Had nothing to do with its class system. It was not, thank heaven, the boys with threadbare coats who became punts, nor the boys with plenty of pocket money who became bloods, according to some theorists. Therefore, if it ought to have been entirely free from seen a community so competitive, so full of snobbery and flunkyism, and ruling class so selfish and so class conscious, or a proletariat so fawning, so lacking in all solidarity and sense of corporate honor. But perhaps one hardly needs to cite experiences for a truth so obvious in priori. As Aristotle remarked, men do not become dictators in order to keep warm. If a ruling class has some other source of strength, why need it bother about money? Most of what it wants will be pressed upon it by emulous flatterers. The rest can be taken by force. There were two blessings at Wyvern that wore no disguise. One of them was my form master, Smeggy, as we called him. I spell the name so as to ensure the right pronunciation. The first syllable should rhyme exactly with fugue, though the white variant spelling was smuggy. Except an oldie. At oldies, I had fortunate in my teachers ever since I was born, but Smuggy was beyond expectation, beyond hope. He was a gray-headed with large spectacles and a wide mouth, which combined to give him a frog-like expression, but nothing could be less frog-like than his voice. He was honey-tongued. Every verse he read turned into music on his lips, something midway between speech and song. It is not the only good way of reading verse, but it is the way to the sort of thing I had heard anyone say before, nor had I ever met before. Perfect courtesy in a teacher. It had nothing to do with softness. Smoky could be very severe, but it was the severity of a judge, weighty and measured without daunting. He never yet, no villainy, ne said in all his life unto no matter wit. He had a difficult team to drive, for our form consisted partly of youngsters, new bugs with scholarships starting there like myself, and partly of veterans who had arrived there at the end of their slow journey up the school. He made us unity by his good manners. He always dressed us as gentlemen, and the possibility of behaving otherwise seemed thus to be ruled out from the beginning. In that room, at least, the distinction between fags and bloods never raised its head. On a hot day, when he had given us permission to remove our coats, he asked our permission before removing his gown. Once, for bad work, I was sent by him to the headmaster to be threatened and raided. The headmaster misunderstood Swiggy's report and thought there had been some complaint about my manners. Afterwards, Smoogie got wind of the head's actual words, at once corrected the mistake, drawing me aside and saying, "There has been some curious misunderstanding. I said nothing of the sort about you. You will have to be whipped if you don't do better at your Greek grammar next week. But naturally, that has nothing to do with your manners or mine." That idea that the tone of conversation between one gentleman and another should be altered by a flogging any more than by a duel was ridiculous. His manner was perfect. No familiarity, no hostility, no threadbare humor, mutual respect, decorum, never let us live with amusia, was one of his favorite maxims. Amusia, the absence of the muses. And he knew, as Spenser knew, that courtesy was of the muses. Thus, even had that he thought, he taught us nothing else. To be in his smoky form was to be in a measure ennobled. Amidst all the banal ambition and flashy splendors of school life, he stood as a permanent reminder of things more gracious, more humane, larger, and cooler. But his teaching, in the narrower sense, was equally good. He could enchant, but he could also analyze an idiom or a textual crux once expounded by Smoogie became clear as day. He made us feel that the scholar's demand for accuracy was not merely pedantic, still less an arbitrary moral discipline, but rather a niceness, a delicacy, to lack which argued a gross and swanish disposition. I began to see that the reader who misses syntactical points in a poem is missing aesthetic points as well. In those days, a boy on the classical side officially did almost nothing but classics. I think this was wise. The greatest service we can do to education today is to teach fewer subjects. No one has time to do more than a very few things well before he's 20. And when we force a boy to be mediocrity in a dozen subjects, we destroy his standards, perhaps, for life. Smoogie taught us Latin and Greek, but everything else came in incidentally. The books I liked Stevens' Crock of Gold, which I had lately read for the first time with great excitement. Here was something very different from the northernness. Pan and Dionysus liked the cold, piercing appeal of Odin and Fury and Frey. A new quality entered my imagination, something Mediterranean and volcanic. The orgiastic drumbeat, orgiastic, but not strongly erotic. It was perhaps unconsciously connected with my growing hatred of the public school orthodoxies and conventions, my desire to break and tear it all. The other undisguised blessing of the cult was the gurney, the school library, not only because it was a library, but because it was a sanctuary. As a bleep used to come free of touching English soil. As the black used to become free on touching English soil, so that the meanest boy was unfathomable once he was inside the gurney. It was not, of course, easy to get there in the winter terms if you were not on the list for clubs. You had to go out for a run. In summer, you could reach sanctuary in afternoon only under favorable conditions. You might be put down for clubs and they excluded you, or there might be either a house match or a call match, which you were compelled to watch. Thirdly, and most probably, on your way to gurney, you might be caught, in fact, for the whole afternoon. But sometimes one succeeded in running the gauntlet of all these dangers, and then the book silence leisures the distant sound of bat and ball, all the brave music of the distant drum, bees buzzing at the open windows, and freedom. In the gurney, I found Corpus Poeticum, Borrelia, and tried vainly but happily to hammer out the originals from the translation at the bottom of the page. There, too, I found Milton and Yeats, a book of Celtic mythology, which soon became, if not a rival, yet a humble companion to Norse. That did me good to enjoy two mythologies, or three, now that I had begun to love Greek, fully aware of their different flavors, is a balancing thing and makes for Catholicity. I felt nearly the difference between the stony and fiery sublimity as Asgard, the green, leafy, enormous, and elusive world of Croacan, and the red branch and Tiernan Og, the harder, more defined, sun-bright beauty of Olympus. I began, presumably, in the holidays, an epic on Cuchulainn and another on Finn in English hexameters and in fourteeners, respectively. Luckily, they were abandoned before these easy and vulgar meters had time to spoil my ear. But the northernness still came first, and the only work I completed at this time was a tragedy. Norse is in subject, the Greek in form. It was called Loki Bound and was as classical as any humanist could have desired, with prologues, protos, episodi, estesima, exodus, stichomythia, and of course one of the passage in Chalcaic septenary with rhyme. I never enjoyed anything more. The content is significant. My Loki was not merely malicious. He was against Odin because Odin had created a world, though sad wisdom of Loki and the brutal orthodoxy of Thor. Odin was partly sympathetic. He could at least see what Loki meant. And there had been old friendship between these two before cosmic politics forced them apart. Thor was the real villain. Thor with his hammer and his threats, who was always egging Odin against Loki and always complaining that Loki did not sufficiently respect the major gods, to which Loki replied, "I pay respect to wisdom, not to strength." Thor was in fact the symbol of the Bloods, though I see that more clearly now than I did at the time. Loki was a projection of myself. He voiced that sense of priggish superiority whereby I was unfortunately beginning to compensate myself for my unhappiness. The other feature in Loki Bound, which may be worth commenting on, is the pessimism. I was at this time living like so many atheists or anti-theists in a world of contradictions and maintained that God did not exist. I was also very angry with God for not existing. I was equally angry with him for creating a world. How far was this pessimism, this desire not to have been sincere? Well, I must confess that this desire quite slipped out of my mind during the seconds when I was covered by the Wild Earl's revolver, by the Chestertonian test, then the test of men alive. It was not sincere at all, but I'm still not convinced by Chesterton's argument. And it is true that when a pessimist's life is threatened, he behaves like other men. His impulse to preserve life is stronger than his judgment. That life is not worth preserving. But how does not prove that the judgment was insincere or even erroneous? A man's judgment that whiskey is bad for him, it's not invalidated by the fact that when the bottle is at hand, he finds desire stronger than reason and succumbs, having once tested life, tasted life. We are subjected to the impulse of self-preservation. Life, in other words, is as a habit forming as cocaine. What then? If I still held creation to be a great injustice, I should hold that this impulse to retain life aggravates the injustice. It is bad to be forced to drink the poor potion. How does it mend matters that the potion turns out to be an addiction drug? Pessimism cannot be answered so. Thinking as I then thought about the universe, I was reasonably in condemning it. And at the same time, I now see that my view was closely connected with a certain lopsidedness of temperament. I had always been more violent in my negative than in my positive demands. Thus, in personal relations, I could forgive much neglect more easily than the least degree of what so strong.